Hi, I'm Dr. Jack West, medical oncologist at City of Hope Comprehensive Cancer Center in Los Angeles. This is Westwind, a podcast focusing on the intersection of cancer care, emerging technology issues in medicine, and healthcare policy. You can find information about subscribing at beaconmedic.com or wherever you find your podcast content. Please leave a review, especially if you like this, and we'd also love to get your feedback at westwindpodcast@gmail.com. I'm happy to be here today with Dr. Mark Lewis, who is the director of GI Medical Oncology at Intermountain Healthcare in Murray, Utah, and also has a very rich history of a lot of things that I think can teach us about the practice of cancer care from a few different perspectives. So thank you so much for joining us, Mark.
Oh, Jack, it's my absolute pleasure. I know you've interviewed many luminaries in oncology, and I know I'm the exception to that. So thank you for including me in your list.
You're going to bring a lot to this. So let's just start with, you know, I think we all have some kind of lame superhero power. Unfortunately, mine is only immunity to caffeine, but I think, you know, yours is that you are an amazing communicator, particularly in the delicate world of oncology and cancer care. And of course, that comes in part from your rich experience that maybe many of us would not envy. But can you start with your kind of superhero origin story of where this all comes from and your background even before you came to this country?
Yeah, absolutely, because it kind of all ties in. And as far as superheroes go, I'm far more Clark Kent than Superman. And I definitely have my kryptonite deep in my genes, as we'll discuss. So as you alluded to, I'm actually not from America at all. I'm actually from Scotland originally, and I could do this whole podcast in a Scottish accent if that would be appealing to your audience. But my family moved from Scotland to Texas, not a traditional move to make, when I was 8 years old. And that was because my father was a minister and a theologian. He was on faculty at the University of Edinburgh School of Divinity, and he got an offer to teach for, at first, only a five-year professorship. It's funny how these things work out. That was in 1987. We came over with the expectation that we would spend roughly half a decade in Texas and then move back to the UK. And the reason this is all germane to my oncology experience is that when you move to the US, all immigrants undergo a chest x-ray as a screen for tuberculosis. And my father's chest x-ray didn't show TB, but we were told it showed a very large mass. It was actually described to him and then to me as a pineapple occupying his right lung. And I've actually written about the experience of not just breaking bad news, but having bad news broken to you essentially by a government bureaucrat. It was really far from ideal. I don't think the message of how serious this was got conveyed properly to my dad, who again was not medical. And I think he really thought that this was going to turn out to be something benign. So when we arrived in Texas, one of our first orders of duty was familiarizing ourselves with the somewhat bewildering American healthcare system. We were used to the national healthcare system in Britain, which has its own problems, as is well documented. But when we got to the US, we had to find insurance coverage. We had to find a cardiothoracic surgeon. And in very short order, after arriving here, my father actually had two surgeries, the first of which was essentially a mediastinoscopy. The cardiothoracic surgeon, I don't think, really knew what they were getting into in my father's chest. They went back 2 days later and performed what turned out to be an R2 resection of what only in hindsight do I realize was a thymic neuroendocrine tumor, a malignant carcinoid. At the time, it was just described to my family in layman's terms as a unusual lung cancer. And it's interesting, my dad was a really clean living guy. He didn't smoke at all. You of all people know that we shouldn't stigmatize lung cancer or link it too causatively to tobacco use. But he was really quite mystified as a minister who had been very scrupulous about his own lifestyle as to why he would develop lung cancer. But that was the term that was used to him.
But just to clarify, you'd also written that he didn't spend a lot of time agonizing over why me.
No, yeah, that's exactly right. He was so interesting. For to have a minister, a man who literally spent his life and work contemplating, you know, our place in the universe, you know, the relationship with God, and, you know, how mortality plays into sin and guilt. You know, Protestantism is actually largely inflected with a sense that, you know, we're inherently flawed, and, you know, we are in need of salvation and redemption. There's various ways of working towards righteousness, as it were. But my father, you're absolutely right. He literally wrote, "Why not me?" And I thought that was such a courageous thing for him to say. He literally had people coming up to him, you know, saying, "You know, this is so unfair that this would happen to you. You know, you've devoted your life to service and, you know, helping the Christian church." And he really had the opposite view, which was that, you know, he didn't really put a whole lot of faith, as it were, in that works righteousness. And he thought he was just as vulnerable to misfortune as others. And in fact, he was so open-minded that he saw cancer or any life-threatening diagnosis that comes from a distance as a gift of perspective over, say, a car accident or some other rapid trauma that just comes out of nowhere. Because, you know, anything that comes with a prognosis that you can contemplate is also a chance to take stock of your life and really really think about your own mortality and your own legacy.
He lived for many years after this, and that left a lot of time for you and your family to watch his treatment and his challenges coping with older cancer therapy and just process his gradual decline.
That's right. He had an R2 resection of his mass, and so there was a substantial amount of cancer left in the mediastinum, and he required radiation therapy. And I actually vividly remember him having a huge red X drawn in his chest in indelible marker, and just going in every day to get zapped, as it were. And that came with a fairly significant amount of toxicity in terms of dysphagia and odynephagia. And then he recurred with metastases in his bones, which were extremely painful. And again, for a man that was so puritanical in his habits, he really, really struggled with the need for opioids. I vividly remember him sort of out loud talking about the challenge of needing morphine and opioids and really being averse to taking an intoxicant. There was two things, I think, Jack, that were providential in the timing of his therapy. One of which was in 1991, he was actually admitted with neutropenic sepsis, and I think was pretty much on the verge of death from infection after myelosuppressive chemotherapy. And his oncologist said, "Well, we've got this new drug called Neupogen. Let's give it a go." And whether or not the GCSF was responsible for his survival at that time and for another 3 years, I don't know. But it certainly seemed like it at the time. And I remember it was like magic. Every day the oncologist would come in and tell us that his neutrophils and white count were higher. And that made an impression on me even as a child that this medicine was almost like, a spell had been cast on his bone marrow. It was really pretty remarkable. On the flip side, what actually killed him in the end, I think, was a hypersensitivity response to paclitaxel. So he had been admitted to the hospital with progression after cisplatin, etoposide, and some other agents. And his oncologist had access to paclitaxel. This was 1994, and said, "Let's throw a Hail Mary." And at that point, it was still extremely allergenic. Not that it's not now, but at that point it was being made, I think, almost directly from the bark of the Pacific yew tree. It wasn't yet semi-synthetic. And he basically had anaphylaxis and died in the hospital, not at home or in hospice or in any comfort. So I kind of think of those years as bookended by, you know, timing. You know, Neupogen came out and saved his life, and then paclitaxel was available to him and arguably may have shortened it. So I've actually thought a lot about that in my career because, you know, as you and I know, the field has changed so rapidly. And I think about drugs that are available to my patients now that really weren't even there even a few years ago.
I was reading some of your account of this and thinking that there's just this ongoing continuum of kind of what a time to be alive or what a time to be practicing oncology that, you know, I remember when Zofran was new and people were talking about, oh, you can't imagine how difficult it was. You'd run into your patient in the mall and they would vomit due to this association of seeing you and getting chemotherapy. And that, you know, the miracle of these newer antiemetics now making it possible to not have yourself associated with intractable vomiting, that's a benefit. But then, you know, in the last 20 years, we've seen chemotherapy become modestly more effective, many times less toxic. And of course, the introduction of targeted therapies and immunotherapy. And we're still babes in the woods with a lot of this. I think that, or I hope that in 5, 10, 15 years, we're going to look back at 2018, 19 and think, oh, God, I'm so glad that we've moved on from that and have newer treatments. I hope that's the case.
Exactly. And I often will tell patients that, you know, I think the big three myths about chemotherapy is that all chemo causes hair loss, all chemo causes horrible nausea and vomiting, and all chemo will put you in the hospital. As it happens, that sort of unholy trinity happened to my dad with some regularity. Basically, every time he had chemo, my mother and I braced ourselves for him to be admitted. These days, I'd say easily 95%+ of my practice is outpatient. I actually even like to play a game with students and residents where when they come to my clinic, I call it the waiting room game, where I ask them to pick out the patients in the waiting room from their spouses and caregivers. And often, aside from giveaways like ports and maybe some alopecia, it's actually getting increasingly difficult to visually differentiate the patient and their caregiver. And I think that's a wonderful thing. I also, to your point about ondansetron, I think that when ASCO, you know, recounted the five greatest advances of the last half century, I think antiemetics were on there. And I understand why, because, you know, when we give treatment, we need to marry efficacy to tolerability. We really can't have one without the other. And I think we're doing thankfully a better job, not yet a perfect job, but a better job of making these treatments tolerable so people can live their lives and do their work and be with their families.
You mentioned your father died from this eventually, and he was not a medical person. As far as I know, you didn't have a lot of physicians in your family, but you chose to go into it. I think that not everyone would have your childhood experience and come away with a feeling that I definitely want to go into medicine or oncology specifically. What was your interaction with or impression of oncologists and the medical world that led you to want to do this?
Yeah, I think it may have helped that I was a 14-year-old at the time. I know that sounds strange, but I basically had the typical strain of teenage rebellion coupled to, and I'm almost ashamed to say this now, but I'll just be very candid with you and your listeners, a very great anger at God. My paternal line is largely composed of ministers, and I'm a prodigal son breaking from the habit of going into the ministry. I will say even now, I think the ministry is one of those professions where if you don't hear the authentic calling to go into it, you really shouldn't pursue being a clergyman. And again, the timing worked out where I was so saddened by the loss of my father. I didn't really feel at that time, at least when I was choosing my career or future path, that the ministry was for me. On a much lighter note, my father's oncologist was absolutely wonderful to me. And I have tried and failed to echo his example in my own practice. What he did was truly remarkable. So my dad died when I was a freshman in high school. And every summer thereafter, through high school and college, I was basically allowed to work in his clinic. And I sort of worked my way up through the ranks. I was a medical assistant. I was an x-ray technician at one point. And I got to see firsthand oncology, not entirely dispassionately, but, you know, from a perspective where it wasn't necessarily my family member getting the treatment. And that made such a huge impression on me. He even stayed in touch with me, you know, years after my father's death. And what I was the most impressed with wasn't even his intellect, which was staggering, but his personal connection with patients. He really took an interest in my father as a theologian and as sort of a Christian thought leader. He was fascinated by that. And as I followed him in clinic, he would do this thing, which now almost seems impossible, which is that he had a paper chart and he would scribble notes about the patient and their family in the margins. And, you know, I suppose a cynic could say this was a contrivance, but, you know, when he went into the room, rather than launching right into neutrophil counts and toxicities, he would talk about whatever, you know, sort of social history, not a list of vices, but the true social identity of the patient that had been addressed at the last visit. And it was this beautiful through line, like a longitudinal relationship like you would have with a friend. And, you know, when I went on to medical school, we were taught that outside of psychology and psychiatry, oncology lets you have the closest interpersonal relationships. And I've definitely come to value that. And I think some combination of my, you know, filial rage that my father was dead and the mentorship I got from his oncologist, some combination thereof is what led me into oncology.
You talk about the experience of so many of us of having medical student disease. You learn about some set of symptoms and convince yourself, oh my God, I've got that. But you actually had reason to look into some of this. You learned more about your father's illness even after the fact, and then started to do your own proto-Google search before Google, I think. And can you talk about your process of learning about MEN1 and how that led you to your own diagnosis?
Yes, I'd say there's a fine line between self-awareness and hypochondriasis. And there's a great quote in Catch-22 where they say, you know, just because you're paranoid doesn't mean that they're not after you. And so I sort of felt both ways, that maybe I was being overly cautious and seeing patterns that weren't there, but I also knew increasingly into my 20s that I had something wrong with me. And the other piece of the puzzle, Jack, is that my paternal uncle, not too long after my father died, had a complication as well. And that was a pituitary macroadenoma presented in classic fashion with bitemporal hemianopsia. He was driving along and he would start clipping cars on either side of him because his peripheral vision was gone. And that was obviously a huge issue. At one point, he'd actually been a driving instructor. So that didn't look very well professionally for him. Regardless, you know, when a rare tumor happens once, like a thymic net, that seems unfortunate. But when you get two sort of rarer tumors occurring, then you start to wonder if, you know, two points make a line. And then the final piece of the puzzle was I developed hypercalcemia. And my very first week of fellowship, I was starting at Mayo in Rochester. I just had horrible abdominal pain. And I will say there are limits to self-diagnosis. I actually thought I had appendicitis because it seemed to me like it was localizing to my right lower quadrant. But in fact, I had a high calcium. And that's actually when everything clicked for me. I still don't have access to my father's records. And it's literally a game of telephone, largely through conversations with my mother, who's wonderful and has an excellent memory, but is also not a medical person. She's also a minister, as it happens. And I did remember from talking to her that my father, almost his entire adulthood, had been really suffering with hypercalcemia, most notably through kidney stones. And he had been told that the problem was excess dairy. But then he omitted milk and cheese with, you know, near, you know, monastic devotion, and still had problems with high calcium. And that's actually when it all clicked for me, is I realized there's only a very few things that can give you hypercalcemia in successive generations. And MEN1 is one of those. So that's actually how I put it together. If I had gotten smarter earlier, what's interesting is the genetic testing for MEN1 for our particular Kindred's mutation didn't come along until 2007. And so I was doing fellowship in 2009. I did have some access to Google, although we'll talk a little bit more about Dr. Google's pitfalls in a minute. And I was pretty convinced as I started my fellowship that this was the pattern of MEN1. And I went to my doctor that I was assigned at Mayo and asked to be tested.
So let's talk about how that's left you in terms of the role of the patient in this journey, because that has evolved over time, and there are mugs and posters that say, please don't confuse your Google search with my medical degree. And I think some tension about this, but I had started a cancer education nonprofit for patients that's really dedicated to the idea that patients can become very sophisticated if they have access to the right information and can be a really untapped resource. What's your view on this as somebody who lived it and shaped your own care?
Yeah, I think I've seen those mugs and slogans too. And, you know, there's some truth in that. I mean, our medical training is years and years of apprenticeship and iterative education, and it really is hard to replicate that. On the other hand, I think that the internet has largely, not entirely, but largely leveled the playing field in terms of access to information. We still have issues with paywalls, We still have issue with misinformation spreading like wildfire in certain corners of the internet and social media. I actually think the way to bridge the two poles of opinion between, you know, doctors being omniscient and patients having quote unquote all the answers, you know, the way I sort of draw the Venn diagram of overlap is to say that the self-advocating patient is the strongest force in medicine. And I say that having been there myself. And without getting too specific regarding neuroendocrine tumors, like the ones that affect my family, sort of the hallmark of these tumors is that they are late to be diagnosed, typically after years of misdiagnosis. So for instance, the carcinoid syndrome, I've seen patients who had classic textbook presentations of it, but it's almost like the fable of the men feeling the elephant. Every doctor was seeing a different piece. So the wheezing was adult onset asthma. The flushing was being attributed to hot flashes. The diarrhea was being attributed to irritable bowel syndrome. So all these different pieces were being identified, but they weren't being assembled into a cohesive whole. And my point there is these patients often will arrive at the diagnosis through their own research. They'll become increasingly dissatisfied with therapies that are not working for them. They'll become increasingly convinced that something is wrong with them. And you know, you mentioned that adage about Dr. Google. You and I well know that another adage we're taught is when you hear hoofbeats, think horses, not zebras. And that may lead us to actually be very practical diagnosticians. But if you don't think about zebras, sometimes you're going to miss whole herds of them that pass you by one during your career. So I think that the internet and quote unquote Dr. Google come with massive caveats, not least of which is that search engine optimization can surface results that are not in any way in your best interest and are highlighted for profit. But it also has to be said that some patients know deep down something is wrong with them. And when they start to search out answers, there may be some at least kernel of truth in what they're finding. I've learned to be very open-minded when patients bring me something from the internet, partly because I know if I completely shut them down, they're probably going to go somewhere else. And I want to engage them in a dialogue. And actually, the most wonderful thing that happens in my oncology practice is a patient might be savvy enough to go to clinicaltrials.gov and bring me a trial that they're eligible for that I'm, to be perfectly honest, might not have previously been aware of. So that I think it does go two ways. I think you have to approach the patient with respect and listen to what they're saying.
We'll continue our discussion with Dr. Mark Lewis in the next episode.
Thanks so much for joining me today for this Westwind podcast. We hope you'll be interested enough to subscribe either by checking out the options at beaconmedic.com. Or looking for Westwind Podcast on iTunes or wherever you find your audio content. Please take the time to submit a review, and we'd also welcome your feedback at westwindpodcast@gmail.com. Until next time, this is Dr. Jack West. Thanks for listening.